Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You mean to wish me a good morning, or do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not?
Please go away. Let me speak for the love of
God! So, instrumental, anything goes. Feel free to sing along if you want.
In Japanese?
If you want to.
If you play it. Sing along if you play it.
Oh, I haven't got it here to play. How does it go?
Yeah, nice try.
Have you ever thought that anything goes and putting on a Ritz are like pretty much the same song?
Yes.
When you're blue, when you don't know. It's kind of the same. It's like the Hollywood version of, like, you know, Volcano Dante's Peak. It's the song version of that.
Yeah, it's the song version, yeah.
Yeah, there's an episode. We should think about songs that are exactly the same.
I like the idea of the movies version.
Yeah. Well,
where we do Dante's Peak and Volcano.
I feel like that's been done 100 times, probably.
Armageddon and Deep Impact.
Maybe we can. Maybe we can find other podcasts that are exactly the same as ours.
And just do those, yeah.
Swap hosts.
Yeah. Just to mess them up.
Ah, shit. G'day, everyone. Welcome to Good Movie Monday. You're listening to the weekly podcast dedicated to nerdy cinematic ramblings. My name is Glenn Cochran. Sitting across from me is Ben Helwig, straight out of Oakley. How are you, mate?
Straight out of the mean streets. I had to kick the crap out of 3 Oakley wogs to get here today. And that's a gang. That's what they call themselves. I'm not being racist. When I was a kid growing up in Oakley, going to Oakley Primary School, they used to tag the school. And you always used to worry if you threw a party when you got to high school and you threw a party, because there was always a rumor that the Oakley Wogs would show up and stab someone.
Oh, if this is your first time listening, you've picked a good one.
Ben's cancelled himself. Usually it takes at least 15 minutes for Ben to cancel himself.
Well, I mean, I was about to say today's show could go in any direction, but it already has.
Talk about, yeah, school gangs.
We're calling this episode Anything Goes, and that is to say that the theme for the show is the fact that there is no theme, and I guess strap yourselves in for some random, nonsensical, non-directional fun.
I think the subtitle should be, I didn't have time to watch anything this week, so I'm just talking about old shit.
Well, I have no idea how your side of this is going to go, but I could tell you that I'm essentially just going to throw some movie titles in the air, kind of like a long version of Lucky Dip that we do on the videos.
Well, you told me that all your films were films that you saw in the cinema in the late 80s, early 90s,
yeah,
is that correct?
Yes, and I didn't want to have a theme, but I thought to myself, what are movies that just instantly come to my mind as, like, you know, nostalgic, and it's movies in the late 80s, early 90s that I saw at the cinemas that had an impact on me.
Right. So, and that's a great idea, and because I had parents who didn't really take us to the movies much, mine would have been movies I saw at the video library in the late 80s, early 90s. Didn't have the same ring to it, and MIF is still on as this episode goes to air.
Yep.
So I thought I would do movies that I first saw on the big screen at MIF.
There you go. So we kind of themed it, but anything goes, mate.
That's right. The mixture of films, like, I've got a page full, which you told me before we went on air, you cannot talk about all of these films.
if it's a listicle, you can.
Yeah, if I just read out the names.
Yep.
But this list is actually, like, there was a period of time, I think from 2000, when I first started kind of working full time after I dropped out of uni.
Mm-hmm.
Like the legend that I am.
Look where you've landed,
and
mate. Good
Movie Monday, that's right. Dropped out of uni for a full-time career in retail. a rewarding full-time career.
Why don't you
in
wait
retail?
Till I've got a mouthful of coffee before you throw a banger at me, mate?
And I would buy them back when they, I think they still do, but I don't know if it's called the same thing, but at the point MIF had it was a silver passport you could buy.
Yeah.
And it was basically a ticket book that gave you one ticket to every session. And there were 160 feature films and God knows how many shorts.
Yep.
And so I would just take 2 weeks or more. I would take my annual holidays from, I think I was working at Borders at the time.
Yep.
Borders and maybe Alternate Worlds. I would take 2 weeks off and go every day and watch 4 or 5 movies a day. Mm-hmm. But then, like, it got to the point, I think, by year 3, where I'd lie in bed in the morning and just go, I just don't want to go. It's too much. I don't want, and then I remember thinking, what? And I was like, I'm just gonna have a sickie. And then I remember thinking, there's no boss. There's no one making me go. If I don't go, I'm just not using today's tickets. Yeah. But yeah, I don't have to pretend. Mm. I don't have to make these excuses to anyone. I could just not go if I don't want to.
Yeah, wow.
So I missed, and I was going through, because MIFF have a great archive on their website of all the programs from the past festivals.
Yep.
And I was looking at them, I'm going, why didn't I see that? I didn't see that there. Why didn't I see it there?
Yeah.
And it's because I was faking a sickie.
Mate, well, I'm not an avid MIFF goer. I have been a few times. Don't have as many stories to share, but we'll get to those in a minute. Hey, we have a website, and it's goodmoviemonday.com. So if you go there, you'll find pretty much everything that we do. We have all of our episodes catalogued. We have videos, all of our specials. We have competitions and a whole lot more. And when you get there, click on through to our social media platforms. There's tabs for all of that. Go check it out. And if you're an avid TikToker, follow us there too. Bite-sized portions of Good Movie Monday.
I actually thought you were going to say, when you said go there, tell them Glenn sent you. And I'm like, it's you. It's, you're the one that's there. Tell me I sent you.
Yeah, well, I'd like to know.
Because I know you say you know, it's got all the things we do. Yeah. We have been very, very generous with that term, because hey, you do it all.
Yeah, but when it comes to, let's say, TikTok, for example, you occupy 90% of that space, mate.
Not intentional.
Although Chloe did do a great belch on our last Up Late episode, and that is there.
Oh, lovely.
Yes. On last week's show, I just want to clear something up, because I remember trying to talk about a movie that David Spade and Chris Farley had started making together and went separate ways. Okay. And I couldn't for the life of me think of what it was. So if there are like avid followers that, you know,
avid fans of Chris yeah. Farley and David Spade out there.
Of Good Movie Monday that are like, you know, latching onto every syllable that comes out of our mouths. The movie was Almost Heroes, and I got it around the wrong way. It was Chris Farley who made the film without David Spade, because apparently they had a falling out during the production and Matthew Perry stepped in to take over for David Spade.
That explains why he's in it. He's far too good looking to be in that movie compared to the rest of the cast.
It was supposed to be David Spade. So look, I feel better. It was irking me all week. I'm like, you know, I've got to let people know what
Hang on,
this was.
Say that again. Sorry. Why did David Spade drop out?
Well, they had a falling out. Him and Chris Farley had a falling out, and I believe it was over the drugs.
Right.
Don't quote me on that, but I recall reading somewhere that they had the lifestyle was becoming an issue.
Right. So, because I thought you were going to say he dropped out because Chris Farley died. I'm like, hang on a second. Chris Farley's the one who should have dropped out, not David Spade. If he died.
Now you're confusing things as much as I did last week.
Yeah. who's a what's in here?
Next week we'll clarify this conversation.
Yeah.
What have we got coming up on today's show? The three guys from Bonehead Weekly are going to swoop in and talk about three random movies just to go with the whole anything goes theme.
And I just want to reiterate, I did mention it in last week's podcast,
yeah.
But I listened to their latest show,
yes,
which was, I think, also a random episode.
Yep.
Where they had no theme. It was the episode with no theme.
They're copying us.
And I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was like hanging out with three pals, and we have never met.
Yeah,
like I've met on Zoom once or twice.
Not in person.
But we've never met in person. Never had like a personal conversation with any of them. But it was like hanging out with three pals. I thoroughly enjoyed the show.
We will have to do a trip to Kentucky and hang out.
I am down.
Yep, me too.
I am downtown Brown with that.
Next week we'll announce our GoFundMe.
Could you imagine if we did that? We did a GoFundMe. We just want to go to America. Pay for our trip.
That's right.
We've both got jobs.
We'll create content.
We promise. Don't, yeah, we should be able to pay for this ourselves. But
Come on.
Oh,
Jesus. Well, Guillermo gets a free pass because he is overseas, gallivanting and doing these things that we wish we were doing.
Son of a bitch.
Exactly. And of course, then there's this legend, Jarrett Garn, the PE instructor extraordinaire. I just want to clarify the PE instructor thing, because if you are a new listener, you have no fucking idea what he... When he says, hey, welcome to PE class, it's like, okay, That's physical entertainment, because that doesn't make sense if you don't know that.
Yeah, otherwise you think it's physical education. Well, it's physical education, but it's not the actual the high school or primary school version.
No,
there's no 12-minute run.
Now that we're Jarrett, I know you're listening, mate. Like, now that we are, like, you know, an R-rated kind of show, unlike when we began, you're welcome to bring the PE teacher back.
Yeah, that PG rating was never going to survive with me on the show.
Well, here he is anyway with what's coming out this week on Home Entertainment. I don't think it's much. I think it's pretty slim pickings this week, so let's find out.
Hey, this is Jarrett, and welcome to PE Class. Now, it's a lackluster week of releases this week, so I'm not going to waste really any time talking about them. The only one I'll mention is that Madman are releasing David Mamet's Glengarry Glen Ross, the excellent Glengarry Glen Ross. However, they're only releasing it on DVD. Why Madman? This title's been released on Blu-ray in the States since like 2012. It's come out multiple times over there on Blu-ray. In fact, there was a special edition that came out several years ago through Shout Factory on their Shout Select label that had a new restoration and a bunch of special features. So why are you only doing DVD? I don't know. It's been out on DVD here locally countless times. It's been in bargain bins. But anyway, let's move on to something more exciting, some news. So first up, Roadshow will be releasing the Warner title Elvis. That's right, Baz Luhrmann's Elvis. They're releasing it on all the formats, 4K, Blu-ray, and DVD, and it's coming out September 21. Next up from Roadshow, another title from the Warner catalog, but a deep cut. It's George Stevens' 1956 classic Giant, with arguably James Dean's best role. My favorite will always be Rebel Without a Cause, but this is an incredible film and an amazing performance. Then finally, from Universal Sony Pictures Home Entertainment and from the Paramount catalog, they're releasing Adrian Lynn's 1987 erotic thriller Fatal Attraction on 4K Ultra HD on October 12th. You remember this one, Michael Douglas and Glenn Close, and the first question you kind of ask is, why is Michael Douglas cheating on his wife with Glenn Close? Have you seen her in this movie? Anyway, that's it for the news, but I'm not going to let you go just yet. I'm going to provide a recommendation. And in the vein of this episode, it is a random recommendation, and that title is God Told Me To from 1976. Now, this one was released back in the day on video here in Australia under the title The Demon by CBS Fox Video. So if you've seen The Demon, you've seen this film. But if you haven't seen this film, or if you've seen it before, you need to see it again. It is incredible. Written, produced, and directed by the legendary Larry Cohen, this one stars Tony LoBianco, Sandy Dennis, and Richard Lynch. It follows a detective who's hunting for answers when a series of mysterious mass killings take place throughout New York City. There's no clear motive as to why these are happening. The only thing that the murderers are telling the police when questioned is, God told me to. It's engaging from start to finish. It's a must-see. And like I said, if you've seen it, see it again. If you haven't seen it, you need to check it out. And now it's just been released by Blue Underground in the US on 4K Ultra HD. So completely restored. It's loaded with special features. And you need to check it out. Why? Because God told you to. Anyway, that's it for me for this week. So until next time, stay physical.
Ah, there we go. All right. Jarrett from Monster Fest, Monster Pictures, whatever you want to call it. He runs their social media. So go over there, give them some likes, but not before you give us a lot of likes.
Yes.
Like, always us first.
Like us first.
All righty, let's do
Well, it's really both for me. I will say one actually gives me a living wage. Yeah. I'm not going to say which one.
Not the one that does the GoFundMe.
But not the one that does the GoFundMe.
So because there's no theme for today's show, anything goes, I'm going to throw some random titles out. Like I said, these are ones I saw at the cinemas, and they did leave an impact. Not necessarily good movies by any means, but three of these I'm going to lump together because I sort of, in my mind, connect them by association. So the first one, Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead.
Yeah, right.
Second one, Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. And the third one, Weekend at Bernie's. So can you pick my connection with those?
Somebody dies in all of them.
Kinda. Well, the first one would be
Weekend at Bernie's.
Yep.
Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead. What was the middle one?
A Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Is death in? Or is he?
Well,
in,
no, that's not the connection.
He's in the second one.
So the way I connect them in my head, it's one of those. It's like when you watch High Fidelity and he connects his movie, his music collection by like autobiographical.
Thanks for that. High Fidelity was one of the movies I saw at MIFF. I was going to talk about.
Really?
No, it's fine. But it was. It totally was.
So the way I connect them, Stephen Herrick directed Bill and Ted and Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead. That was sort of a back-to-back thing. So in my mind, I remember feeling really movie smart when I was young, like that I knew that fact. Oh, it's the same director as Bill and Ted. And that was like my first little, you know, bit of an ego trip.
If that's the case, I want to say, it just goes to show how sexist Hollywood and not just Hollywood, but how sexist the world is. Because Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead was fucking huge.
Yep.
Like it. And Christina Applegate was huge because of it.
Yep.
As big, I would say, as Bill and Ted.
Yep.
Yet Keanu Reeves, massive career. Christina Applegate,
well, that
TV career.
Is that because she went into television? Or was she in television before it?
She was already in Married with Children before, as far as I know.
Yet he had been a movie actor up until then as well. So I think maybe it was just the path she was already on.
Yeah. Well, he could be in action movies.
Yeah.
She, at that time, maybe could.
Well, I mean, I'm sure she doesn't bemoan her career. She's had a pretty good one.
She's had a pretty good career.
But anyway, so then Weekend at Bernie's and Babysitter, I lump them together because they both sort of deal with dead corpses. Even though in Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead, you don't really see a corpse. They dump her at the morgue.
Yeah.
And she happens to have all the money on her. And they can't go back and get it. And then, not to mention, like, both of those movies with the course, it's not like it's fucking like criminal what they're doing. Like,
no.
That's the thing that you watch it now, it's like, man, the fucking FBI would be after you.
I just like they not once do they talk about the smell.
No.
Like of the especially Weekend at Bernie's. Like, he's in the heat. He's in the hot sun. Bernie
and it is so hot the tar melts on the roof.
On the roof. So Bernie would stink.
He would, particularly in part two.
Yeah.
You know, they put him under the sea on the poster art, so that's how they preserved the brine him, the pickle.
Oh yeah, they pickled him.
But anyway, let me focus on Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead. I kind of also in my mind I watched it recently in the lead up to this and it kind of made me think of Adventures in Babysitting and License to Drive. It's very similar, like if you combine them. And Keith Coogan is in Adventures in Babysitting too, and he's the brother in...
Which one would you say, and this is a controversial one would you which one do you prefer, Don't Tell Mum or Adventures in Babysitting?
Adventures in Babysitting all the way.
Me too. Yeah.
It's a great movie. I don't care for any of the remakes, but that original with like Vincent D'Onofrio as Thor.
As Thor. And I have to say, as much of a crush as I had on Kelly Bundy does not hold a candle to the crush
Andrew
I had Shue. On Elizabeth Shue.
Did I just say Andrew Shue?
you just added yourself as a Billy from Melrose Place fan.
You know what that was? I wrote an article about him not long ago. Yeah, right. So when you said Shue, I'm like, fucking Andrew.
Remember when he played the wife beater in Rainmaker?
God, you have to take it
what
there.
What a hunk.
The tagline for Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead was...
I love Andrew Shue.
Fuck. I'm never going to live that one down. Anyway. I think he's a social media entrepreneur now in real
life. Him and Hobie from Baywatch.
Yeah.
Wasn't it? Remember that when like Facebook and stuff first got kind of... And I think he started in MySpace, but there was all those articles about how Hobie used MySpace... to get laid. Like he was this whole big thing where he would because do you remember those Rate Me websites?
Yes.
Rate Callie and all that kind of stuff where like that was all kind of him.
He said Rate, RATE.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Rate Callie. Yeah. Rate. Sorry. You don't want to get those mixed up.
No.
Although they're just as bad. Well, maybe not just as bad, but close. But that was all, yeah. But that a lot of that was Hobie.
Yeah.
And Andrew Shue kind of,
Well, Andrew Shue also runs a lot of charity these days, so that's where he's at.
Hobie does not do that.
No. The tagline for Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead was, it's Home Alone times five. And that freaks me out to think that Home Alone came before Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead, because it feels the other way around to me.
Yeah.
But anyway, the roll call on this is pretty good. Yeah, Christina Applegate and Keith Coogan, as we said. Josh Charles is in there. Joanna Cassidy, David Duchovny playing a sleaze bag with a ponytail.
Wasn't David Duchovny also in one of the Vacation movies as the next door neighbors?
No,
in Christmas.
Wasn't that Beethoven?
Is it Beethoven? Yeah, where him
and
Elaine?
Oh, no, you're confusing two movies. Like, she plays the next door neighbor in Vacation 3, like the Christmas Vacation, with a different guy as a husband. Right. And he plays a similar character in the Beethoven.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Old Man Hellwig strikes again.
Bit of a Twin Peaks double here, because Kimmy Robertson is also in it. You know, the Lucy from the reception in Twin Peaks. Danielle Harris, you know, like, it's a good cast.
I was going to say classic, but I'm like, what does that mean? We've never met Danielle Harris.
Well, the film was originally written for Winona Ryder. Like, she was supposed to be the star. Yeah, right.
That actually makes a lot of sense.
She declined it in favor of Edward Scissorhands and, what was the other, Mermaids.
Right.
I mean, she chose wisely.
She made a good choice.
But
why would they just wait?
But the thing is, after Winona Ryder pulled out, they then offered it to Justine Bateman.
Yeah,
she
right.
was originally, I mean, back in the Mallory days, she would have been pretty good for it.
Well, she did Satisfaction.
Yeah.
Satisfaction. And she wasn't in Mystic Pizza, was she? That was Julie Roberts.
No, that was Julie Roberts, yes.
And then she did all those movies where she plays a blind woman being stalked.
Yeah.
And her career went down the toilet.
That's right. She became an author as well, I think. That's where she spent.
But then she's in that web series where she... The Supermarket of the Stars, where she's like the trolley girl and Ed Bagley Jr. works the counter, and it's all these kind of out-of-work actors. It's their kind of, you know, like, instead of being waiters, they work at this supermarket, and everyone, all the people who work at the supermarket are all out-of-work actors. Have you ever seen that?
I haven't seen it.
That was in the kind of early days of YouTube.
Well, speaking
which
of
which, that
days.
Whole, you know, there's that show that's set in IKEA now, Ileana Douglas, because Ileana Douglas, I think, is the instigator of that Supermarket of the Stars show as well.
She's obsessed.
But then it kind of it branched out,
yeah, okay.
And they picked it up for a prop, and then IKEA came on board as a sponsor. So instead of working at the supermarket, they all work at IKEA.
So fucking weird.
Yeah.
Jennifer Love Hewitt was supposed to play the youngest daughter, but
she was doing the Barbie workout.
No, Kids Incorporated would not let her go out of her contract.
Yeah, wow.
And so that's where Danielle Harris came in and took the role.
Wow. Kids Incorporated. Well, I mean, yeah, it didn't do any harm to Martika's career.
No, that's right. And if you Google Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead, you'll find out that the writers were most inspired by Risky Business when they made it. And you can see that connection when you watch the trajectory story. Fox originally didn't want the film. They wanted it much lighter, and so they shelved it. So this movie actually would have been made a lot earlier had it not been for Fox.
For Fox. Another great decision from Fox. Yeah, it makes you understand why they are now owned by Disney.
And they also did not want Stephen Herrick directing. They didn't think he was the right person for it after Bill and Ted. And I'm thinking, hang on, what the fuck are you talking about? Yeah. Bill and Ted?
Why would a hit movie...
Yeah. They didn't think he was right for the material. I mean, at that point, he'd made Bill and Ted and Critters. Like, come on. Like, Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead and Bill and Ted and Critters. Like, it's kind of like... Those first two films morphed, make Babysitter, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Anyway, he went on, of course, to do Mighty Ducks and...
another classic.
Mr. Holland's Opus, Three Musketeers, 101 Dalmatians, Holy Man. He's made like 20 20 movies in his career, and at least half of them are pretty
fucking
would have
been more
great.
Impressed if he'd made Dave. Not Dave.
That was Ivan Reitman.
No, but what's the other one with Eddie Murphy where he's in the guy's head?
Oh, Meet Dave.
Meet Dave.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
But here's the clincher. This is classic. So some directors who turned it down. So before Stephen Herrick, you had John Landis turn it down, Joe Dante turned it down, John Hughes turned it down, Richard Donner turned it down, Amy Heckling turned it down, Chris Columbus, John Badham, and Joel Schumacher turned it down.
I mean, it's the cream of the crop except for the last guy.
Joel Schumacher. But I mean, I can totally see this being a Joe Dante or Chris Columbus movie.
Yeah, like, totally.
It's totally up their alley. And I think John Hughes didn't want it because he only directed what he wrote.
Yeah, right. You know? Well, I reckon Dante, if Dante would have done, it would have been a darker film
very
again.
Very Burbs-ish.
Yeah.
For sure. Anyway, Don't Tell Mum the Babysitter's Dead. There we go. We've landed on one for our Anything Goes episode. Oh, and there's a Boom Crash Opera song in there too, which I thought was pretty awesome.
Oh, lovely. Yeah,
forgot
right.
about that. And the thing that stuck with me the most, like things that I remember seeing this at the cinemas.
Was there a Rat Cat song in
it? It was PG on the poster, and back then you had big fat PG ratings at the bottom of the poster, and yet there's a really blatant F-bomb right within the first 10 minutes.
I think you're allowed to have one.
In a PG? I don't think you're allowed to have any.
I thought the rule was one.
So I thought that was M. Anyway, I remember at the time thinking
Was that before they had the M rating?
No, I don't know, but regardless, in my mind at the time, I'm like,
or PG-13, before they had PG-13.
Yeah, I don't know, but that was a TV-only rating, so who the fuck knows?
I don't know. I thought the PG-13 rating was invented for a Spielberg movie.
No, that's the American PG-13.
Yeah. Oh, you're talking.
I'm talking about in Australia. We had our PG rating with the big rectangle box and the PG in it.
Yeah, then we definitely had M. We didn't have R. That's why you had all these horror films that were M rated. Like, Texas Chainsaw Massacre is M rated.
No, the other way around. Like
that's right. We had M and we had R. We didn't
have
MA.
Of the Lambs was the one that introduced that little baby. But anyway, so Steve Coogan's putting a pot of weed on his window and it falls out the window and he just goes, fuck. I'm like, that's very articulated and not at all PG.
Yeah, I like that back then, I've requested, at one point I was looking at doing something about all those movies that were banned in Queensland, and under the Freedom of Information Act, you can request all of the classification reports from that period. And they, I'm an R about it, but they eventually send it to you. And a lot of the early classification decisions were just like one guy going, I reckon this is probably an M.
Yeah.
Whereas now it's very, like, you tick boxes for every swear word, every slap, punch, kick, or whatever it is, and it tallies up at the end. It's like an equation.
It used to be open to interpretation.
It was back then, it was...
whatever that guy thinks.
Yeah. And it was like, if you're in a bad mood on the day...
Yeah.
You know,
you're fucked.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, what are some movies you'd like to talk about? Miff me, mate.
Well, I'm looking at some of the. I saw a lot of Kim Ki-duk movies.
Oh yeah.
At Miff back in the day, I'm pretty sure.
And the thing about film festivals, for people that haven't been to one, is most of the movies you see at film festivals, you're probably never going to see again. Half of them don't see the light of day afterwards.
Well, that's it. That's how I used to, for the most part, I used to try and pick movies that I didn't think were going to get major releases after the festival.
Mm-hmm.
Because it just made sense. And I did see some, like there's some like High Fidelity that we talked about earlier, Wonder Boys, you know, those movies I knew were getting proper releases, but
when they're star-studded,
sometimes you want to take a break from all the art house and just watch something commercial,
bloody oath.
And have a nice relaxing time. Like, I think Virgin Suicides was there.
Must admit, I feel relieved when I see those movies on the festival schedules. It's sort of like if you are committed to a lot, that's like a little break in between.
Yeah, and look, and it was a different time. Like the movies that I'm talking about specifically, really, for the most part, were all in that 2000, 2001, 2002 kind of period.
I reckon that's when I first went to the festival,
and it was a lot different then. Like there was a lot of films at the it's when it was the kind for me. It was the golden period because it was. Greater Union, the venues were Greater Union, the Capitol, the Forum, and Village.
Oh, I miss.
So you could run from one to the other and kind of make the next session. Didn't matter where it was, you could kind of get there.
Yeah.
Whereas now they're at the Astor and they're at the Lido, travel. And you know it's a much greater task if you're Pentridge, like if you're kind of close to it. Mm. But. It was also, there were no queues, really, except for these, like, funnily enough, these big films, they had queues.
Yeah.
The big Hollywood ones, because audiences are still audience.
And they're watching them ahead of release.
That's right.
Yeah.
It was like, it's, you know, you definitely had bragging rights. Sneak, but I saw movies like, do you remember Angst?
Yeah, totally. Is that Kylie Minogue in that?
Not Anya Colby. It's the one from Heartbreak High. Abby Tucker.
That's
and she was there. She was, and that was the other amazing thing. Like, I went to see that, and we were pretty much... That played at the Capitol, and there used to be that Kill City bookshop, kind of a couple of doors down a flight of stairs, and I used to go down there and I'd buy. I was at the time I think I was reading all the kind of Conan books, and someone had done novelizations of The Bill,
and
so I was like I picked up those for a couple of bucks, and I would just sit there reading them in the lobby, waiting to go in for the movie, and I'm there sitting next to Abby Tucker, waiting to go into Angst, not knowing that in 10 minutes' time I was going to see her boobies for the first time, and then feel all embarrassed. I'm like, oh, because
Just for your Melburnians out there listening, I was in the city the other day, standing in Bourke Street, looking in one direction where Hoyt's City Centre used to be, the great labyrinth of cinemas that used to be there. Then in the other direction is where the Greater Union used to be, and fuck, I felt nostalgic. I'm like, I miss that stuff.
Well, there was, so like if you stood on Russell Street, you looked on the corner of Russell and Burke.
Yep.
You could look up. That's where Hoyt's.
Yep.
Hoyt's was. You look down. That's where Village and Chinatown Cinemas, which was a huge
Chinatown
cinema.
Chinatown Cinemas were great.
Or you look down Russell Street, and that's where Greater Union was.
Yep.
And then if you kind of like a little diagonally, they had the Lumiere, had the Kino, they had they had a bunch of cinemas.
What a glorious time.
Yeah. And now, like now, MIFF, at least, like I think this year, I don't think they're doing it again this year, but you know, a couple of years prior, the last time I kind of went on a really kind of regular basis, but they're doing stuff at the Comedy Center. Like they're doing it at venues that aren't traditionally cinemas.
Yeah.
And they all have seats like the Astor seats.
Yeah. Classic.
And stuff. And you're like...
What is it Frank Capra said? That every time a cinema closes, a projectionist gets his reels?
Yeah.
So what did you see at MIFF? The first film I ever saw at MIFF was The Irrefutable Truth About Demons. New Zealand horror film.
I honestly couldn't
tell Carl Urban.
Carl Urban. Yeah. I couldn't tell you what the first film I ever saw at MIFF. But I do remember going to see... these two films by Kim Kiduk, The Bad Guy and The Isle, maybe it's just Bad Guy and The Isle. And Bad Guy, I found both these movies were so shocking. Like they were incredibly full on, like graphic violence and graphic sex stuff.
Because they don't have to rate them, do they, at the festivals?
You did back then. You don't...
Unclassified, wasn't it?
Well, no, they weren't rated like a film for general release, but you used to basically have to do everything that you would do for a rating.
Yep.
You send it off to the classification board in a sheet with every classifiable element listed on a piece of paper, and they would just give it a tick. You just didn't have to pay for it.
Yeah, gotcha.
Like you did, and it didn't get recorded officially, but you virtually had to do all the work. Now it's much different. Now you just go, I reckon this is MA, I reckon this is R, and they go, we trust you. And if somebody complains, then... we'll have there'll be a problem,
right.
Which is what happened when I think the Sydney Underground Film Festival played Father's Day, and we were playing it.
I remember
at MIFF, but I didn't bother submitting it because I'm like, well, I'm getting it classified for the DVD release, which is coming out like a month later.
Yeah,
and they refused its classification, and then people went, hang on, how can you refuse it if the Sydney Film Festival or Sydney Underground Film Festival just played it, and then Sydney Underground Film Festival, I think they got into a bit of trouble.
And
and by trouble I mean an email was sent.
But that was an outrageous excision you had to make for that concession, mate. That was like the best moment of the entire film had to go.
Yeah.
Oh, anyway.
Yeah, we had to cut out the all the cock eating. But in Bad Guy is a magnificent film. It's the classic tale, and this has always been my review whenever I talk about it. It's a classic tale of a boy meets girl, girl rejects boy.
Yeah.
So boy impoverishes girl's family and then whores girl out to fishermen on the dock. And then girl falls in love with boy.
Well, lovely.
Such a dark and weird film. And The Isle is, if anything, even darker. And it's all set, this guy kind of kills his wife or his girlfriend. And then he takes off.
Mm.
And he ends up, he just goes on the run. And he ends up on this weird kind of lake where this woman, she kind of works on the shore. And she runs the kind of the bait shop and provides food to the people and they kind of live on these, they're not even houseboats. It's literally like a raft with a covering that you can sleep in.
Yeah.
And they fish on the lake and they're out there for, you know, weekends whatever. But she's also a bit kind of nuts. Like at one point right at the start of the film, one of the businessmen on the lake who come out for the lake kind of mistreats her a little. And then, so, you know, a day later or whatever it is, he's out in the boat and he's kind of squats down to take a shit. And unfortunately, Kim Ki-duk decides you need to see what this guy taking a shit looks like. So the camera is underwater, but you see this guy's ass come down and the shit come out and it is shocking. But then she swims up underneath it with a knife and just...
Oh, Kim Ki-duki.
He kiduks him. She kiduks him. But you know, I'm sitting there watching this at MIFF, and the stuff, it just keeps getting more and more outrageous. Yeah. So in the end, I'm sitting there, and I saw this at the Village Cinema, I am pissing myself laughing at just how outrageous this film is. Yeah. The rest of the cinema is silent.
Yeah. Yeah. Far out, man.
But to my knowledge, those films, I don't think Madman even released them. They did not get releases here. I had to buy imports. They're messed up films. Great.
You just reminded me of a time I did go to MIFF. I took my wife, was my girlfriend at the time, and we saw a film. It wasn't Lars von Trier, but it was something like that. And there was this scene where there was a pair of scissors over a pair of nipples or over a nipple. And at any moment, it could slice, right? So it's this moment, the tension is...
Scissors with Sharon Stone?
No, the tension is mounting. And they're holding those scissors there, sort of, you know, it's flexing in and out a little bit. The whole audience is in suspense. And my wife does not like horror movies or, you know, she's the Hallmark chick, right? Mm. And the silence, she's sitting there just going, oh, fuck, oh, fuck. And suddenly a ripple of laughter goes through the audience. And the moment, the tension was just taken out of that cinema. And we came out and we're on the sidewalk and everyone's talking about, did you hear that woman? We're like, hun, we better go. All it takes is one to say it was her. And then me by association, no, thank you very much. Anyway, good one, sir. We'll talk about a few more in a minute. But first, how about we listen to me, Spruikin? You heard me right. I'm here to talk about Newsly. You already know that. Have you got it yet? Do you listen to us on it? If not, why not? Check out the Newsly app. It is an awesome super app where you get all of your news, whatever you're into, whatever's trending, it will read news stories back to you in a natural human voice. And it's got a podcast area. We're on there. We're trending. And we'd love you to get us onto your phone. So download the Newsly app. It's completely free. And it gives you access to all the trending news articles from around the world. Over 80 countries to be exact. And here's the kicker. Even though it's free, if you're interested in subscribing to their premium service, you can get an entire month for free using the code Monday without the O. That's MNDAY. So why don't you get to it? Newsly.me. Check it out. It's awesome.
I'll be guiding you through this.
brings the tone down a little bit. But Magic, what a beautiful song. We couldn't do this show without, you know, paying a little bit of tribute to Olivia Newton-John, Australia's darling. And that is a great song.
It is a great song. I'm very upset. And I had this conversation with someone on Instagram, with Kate from MIF, actually, on Instagram the other day about how disgusting it is that the only version of Magic on Instagram that you can add to your stories is the live version.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And don't get me wrong, I understand the attraction to a live version of a song and all that sort of stuff. But, you know, for me, give me a studio version where they've repeated a line 300 times to make it perfect.
Yes.
And it's been engineered to within an inch of its life. That's the version of the song I want to hear. That's the version I grew up with, I listen to, I like.
Look,
don't give me an epoxy live version.
And don't get me wrong, like, I think this is the perfect song for this episode. It's a really fun song and it's a fun movie, but I know you originally wanted a song from Tomorrow, right?
Tomorrow, yes.
And
I was actually going to talk about Tomorrow before the theme kind of...
We couldn't use the music because it was so strictly copywritten and like we couldn't...
It's so bizarre that the music from that movie, which is a almost forgotten / unknown film...
And yet we get away with...
I'm shocked that you've even heard of it.
I've seen it.
Yeah.
I enjoy it. Like, I just remember those weird aliens at the start.
Yeah.
And it's
like Voyage of the Rock Aliens.
Well, it's like the monkeys, really. It's like they're... They made the movie because they wanted to create a new rock band or pop band.
Yeah.
You know, it's like Partridge Family combined with, you know.
Yeah, The Apple. It's all of that kind
totally.
Of, you know. Yeah.
Totally. And I've heard horror stories about it, but then I've also heard retrospective things that Olivia Newton-John has said that, you know, the movie was a shambles, but geez, it was fun.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So I'm devastated that we couldn't share that music with people, but go and watch Tomorrow. I looked it up. It's on YouTube.
Lovely.
In entirety.
For the life of me, I think Umbrella may have brought the DVD out
at
some point.
Yeah.
I could not for the life of me find it when I was looking for it.
I think there was a lot of controversy about that one too, because I think it was shelved for many years because the producer hated it so much that he didn't want anyone to see it until he was dead. And fortunately for everyone, he died, so everyone got to see it.
Got to see it. Well, it's also one of those things where you're like, no one can see this, but hang on, Olivia Newton-John is huge right now, so you'll make a fortune. Yeah. Okay, maybe a...
I would love to see that at a festival. Like a retrospective screening, you know? Oh, anyway, so there we go. You know, rest in peace, Olivia Newton-John. Like, it's a big deal, you know, the lost her. So let's talk about some more movies. I don't know, this is a weird transition, but from Olivia Newton-John to Fred Savage. I want to talk about Fred Savage movies. So what are your thoughts on The Boy Who Could Fly?
Well, all I really remember from The Boy Who Could Fly is the Fred Savage stuff.
That's exactly right. So this movie, all I remember from being a kid seeing it at the cinemas was he's in his camos, he's riding a trike, he's got a water gun full of piss. And
he's being harassed by bullies on the street. Yeah. And then finally he decides to get his own back.
And I remember belly laughing when the bully goes, "Oh, you're going to shoot me with water?" And he goes, "No, piss."
Yeah, he goes, "You think I'm free?" You think I'm scared of a water pistol? It's not water. Piss.
And that tickled me pink when I was a kid. But look, this movie, it's a movie that appeals to kids in a different way than it appeals to adults. Because as a kid, I never picked up on the autism stuff. It's a boy with autism, right?
Yeah, no, I just thought he was just like, he was just a kind of a weird kid
and look,
who could fly. Like, I mean...
Well, this is the other thing. I don't want
the fact that he could fly... justifies all the other stuff.
This is a movie that is 30 years old, and I can tell you now, as an adult, I'm disappointed that he can fly. Like, I kind of wanted it to be he had autism and it was his imagination, right?
Yeah.
But in the end, he does fly.
He does fly.
Right? But as a kid, I wanted him to fly.
I wanted to fly, totally.
You know, and that's what I thought it was about. And
I mean, for me, this movie was always up there with Peanut Butter Solution. Like,
totally.
Yeah, they were together at the movies, you know, along with things like The Millionaire Cat and like those kind of Disney movies that you would borrow from Movie Land.
Yes.
You know.
Many times
on
over.
Your mum would take you to the video store on a Saturday afternoon to shut you up.
Well, this is one of them. I used to borrow this. I saw it at the cinemas, but I'd borrow it all the time. Had a tasty little clamshell with a great little cover up.
And it's one of those movies too that when you take it up to the counter, your mum go, "Again? You've seen that one."
I got banned from the video store. Mum gave me an ultimatum. She says, "You can either hire Follow That Bird Again and never rent another movie, or you can choose something different and rent as many times as you want." I still took Follow That Bird because I caught her bluff. I know how to shut myself up, Mum. Anyway, The Boy Who Could Fly, this is wonderful. Like, it's dark too, because these two main characters, you got a teenage girl whose dad commits suicide, right? And then an autistic kid next door whose parents died in a plane crash. So they're both dealing with loss. But you don't put that in kids' movies anymore.
No.
It just doesn't happen.
No, it's become so sanitized now that there's no dealing with issues in kids' films.
And it's not like it damages kids. Because as a kid, that stuff washed over me. And it was the flying stuff that mattered, right?
Yeah.
And then as an adult, you watch it and you go, far out, man. Like, that's heavy stuff. Directed by Nick Castle.
Yeah.
You know,
The Shape.
The Shape from Halloween. Jay Underwood was in it. There's some Disney alumni right there.
Wasn't he? What was because he made other movies where he played a robot.
Oh, Not Quite Human?
Not Quite Human,
were they Disney? I think they were.
I think they're Disney.
Three of them, and with, what's his name? Alan
Thicke.
Thicke, that's right. Lucy Deakins played the girl, from, was it Uncle Buck? She was the daughter.
Is that what she's from?
I think it is. You might want to look that up while I'm doing this. Bonnie Bedelia is in it.
Love Bonnie Bedelia.
And Colleen Dewhurst, and I remember her, like, she was fucking Anna Green Gables.
Yeah, right.
She was a bit scary, but, but yeah, like, I think this was the movie that Fred Savage did first, and it kind of made him a little bit of a Hollywood, I guess, hot commodity, because he did go on, obviously he would eventually go on to the Wonder Years, but he made movies like The Wizard. I saw that at the cinemas. Vice Versa. How good's Vice Versa?
Vice Versa is great.
Oh,
and she was Lucy Deakins, just sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, yeah.
She was in The Great Outdoors.
Oh, I knew she was a daughter
and Cheetah.
There you go. If you remember, that's Cheetah. That's the John Hughes connection with The Great Outdoors.
Yeah.
Cool. Actually, let's talk about
Little Nikita.
Cool. Let's talk about The Wizard for a moment. So that's one of the most genius marketing ploys ever put to cinema.
I like that they basically remade it with that Neil Patrick Harris movie on Netflix. What's the one? It's all about the Nintendo, where he wants to get the Nintendo, and only the rich kid has one in the street. So he goes on the kind of quest to get it. Because I remember, I didn't have a Nintendo. I've never had a Nintendo. Never got one.
Yep.
But I remember I wanted that power glove
with
a passion. It's bad. But it's the shittest. The shittest controller ever invented, the power glove. I honestly don't know why, in this modern age, when they're redoing all of that stuff, why no one's actually made like a cool power glove that works.
Well, the purpose of the film was to sell the power glove and to promote Mario Brothers 3.
Yeah.
Because Mario Brothers 3 was the big reveal in the movie. Like, the promise of the marketing was, we're going to reveal a brand new game, and you get there and it's Mario 3. Which is arguably Nintendo's greatest game of all time. So that was a movie that had a big impact on me, but Vice Versa as well. Like, that's Freaky Friday with the roles reversed. But what I didn't know until I was reading up on this is that Vice Versa, in literature terms, the book, came long before Freaky Friday, and Freaky Friday was adapted as like the role reversed version of it.
Right. Wasn't there also, Freaky Friday would have been before, but wasn't there one with...
There's heaps of them.
George Burns.
Yeah, that's 18 Kurt again. Cameron.
Yeah.
18 again. You had Dream a Little Dream. You had
with the chorus.
Like Father Like Son. Yeah, Dream a Little Dream 2 was with the role reversal.
Right.
Like Father Like Son with Kurt Cameron and Dudley Moore.
And Dudley Moore.
So Vice Versa was a book written in 1882. All about a father and son that swap bodies.
Yeah, right.
And then Freaky Friday wasn't published until 1972, which, was taking that concept. So everyone used to say, oh, Vice Versa, it's just a rip-off of Freaky Friday. It's like, oh, no.
No.
So there we go. I got my little Fred Savage out of my system. He's a controversial figure these days.
Is he?
Oh, yeah. You just read up on Fred Savage now.
Oh, right. He was in a great movie about sex addiction, I remember, which I think I've mentioned before on the show.
It might have something to do with the trouble he's in.
Okay, it's one of those. Now, this movie, it's such a great idea. Like, in the start of the movie, he's going out with this super hot woman who's like a model. And because he's going out with her, he's allowed into the world of the beautiful people.
Mm-hmm.
And then one day he catches her cheating on him. And so they break up. And all of a sudden, he doesn't understand why. All of a sudden, he has no access. Like, all those people he thought were his friends and stuff, none of them are his friends anymore because he is like the ugly one. And like, he doesn't get into that stuff. He can't, And it is that kind of thing, that the only time that women are ever attracted to you is when you have a girlfriend. Like, when you're single, they want nothing to do with you. And that's kind of the thing he's facing. And then he descends into kind of sex with prostitutes and porn and stuff, and it becomes this whole. It's got this great moment. One of my favorite moments in film, where he's in Las Vegas and he's looking on the computer for a prostitute to bring up to his room, and he finds one, and it's like a porn star. The image on the thing is like, oh yeah, it should be great. He orders her. The woman who gets to the door is like in her 40s. Doesn't look anything like the girl thing. She's like, oh, you don't look anything like your picture. And she's like, do you want me to leave? No.
Well, before I throw it over to your next one, I just want to acknowledge the fact that we spent maybe 10 seconds talking about 18 again, and we managed to get George Burns' name in there, right? Yeah. But we spent like a few minutes talking about Vice Versa and didn't mention Judge Reinhold. Who was the other character, the father figure?
The father, yeah.
It's not a stretch to think of him as a little boy because his personality is essentially like a goofy teenager.
I think it's amazing, like, when you look back at who the teen stars, who the teens were in these movies, and then who the adults were.
Yeah, I know.
And like, and then you think, and you look, and what the last one of these movies, I think, was that one with Matthew Perry. And
it's a remake. It's 17 again. It's 18 again remake.
18 again, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's Matthew Perry and
Zac Efron.
Zac Efron.
Yeah.
And you're like, yeah, look, the careers are, once you play the adult in one of these movies, your career seems to drop off.
But also kind of think, like, you look at Matthew Perry in that movie and he doesn't seem that old to do the big gender swap. Like, I guess maybe the remake had George Burns was like practically 200 when he
I think, but the thing that I find most ridiculous about those films is that people, as a rule, in general, people don't really change. If you're an extrovert in high school, you're an extrovert as an adult.
Yep.
If you're an introvert in high school, you're an introvert as an adult. So him being the most popular guy in school as a kid to being a schlub, you're like, his personality wouldn't. Because in his head, you're still the same person as a teenager. Like, you still. It doesn't make any sense how these people have changed all so right. much.
Enough Fred Savage and Zac Efron. On to you, sir.
These movies have absolutely no connection to each other. But I did see one.
They were all at MIFF.
They were all at MIFF. I did see Wonder Boys. That's where I saw Wonder Boys for the first time. And I absolutely love Wonder Boys.
It's a good movie.
It's based on a Michael Chabon novel, Michael Douglas. It is full of kind of, I think, well, Robert Downey Jr. during the slump in his career. And it's, to this day, I still think it's probably the best film he's ever actually done.
Yep.
Or at least the best character he's ever played.
What a bloody career he's had. Like, he's got so many phases to his career.
Yeah. Like, really, really weird. And this one, he's basically, it's like he's playing himself.
Yeah, yeah.
Tobey Maguire, Katie Holmes is irresistible in this movie, except to Michael Douglas. Even Henry Thomas. And I remember when Henry Thomas pops up in it. And I remember thinking, surely Henry Thomas must be in his 80s or something. And he is like, you know,
what?
Seemingly 15, 20 years younger than Michael Douglas. And I was just like, well, how is that? But another movie, I saw the original Mostly Martha.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which they remade as No Reservations with Catherine Zeta-Jones.
I love Mostly Martha.
But Mostly Martha is such a fantastic film.
Yeah, it is. I love food. Foreign food movies really appeal to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a weird romantic comedy because it's like the romance is actually between this woman and her niece who she gets kind of lumbered with.
Mm. It's a different love.
When her mother dies.
Yeah.
Who seems to be, because she's also, she's very weird, the Martha character. She's she's incredibly introverted.
She expresses herself through food.
Through food, and has trouble expressing herself in any other way.
That's right. It's like water for chocolate, like the same thing. Like expresses her love through food.
Yeah,
yeah.
Except it doesn't make people horny when they eat her food.
Those damn ethnics.
They really. It's German. they strip the passion out of it. Like they bring an Italian in to draw it out of her. But it's a great soundtrack. Highly recommend it. Don't bother with No Reservations. It's pap in comparison.
It's serviceable. Like, you know, if you only see that, it's a decent film. But if you have seen Mostly Martha, you're like, no comparison.
Yeah.
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 Because who's the shit? Who's the
Aaron Eckhart?
Yeah. I mean, I like Aaron Eckhart some of the time.
I put No Reservations in that whole serendipity kind of no rom-com realm. Or Return to Me. It's like, you know,
I mean, look, I love Return to Me.
Yeah, me too.
Serendipity is a movie that I have a lot of trouble with because I I really don't like John Cusack in it, and I don't like Kate Beckinsale in it, but I love John Corbett in it. Like, his whole stuff is some of the funniest stuff
I love that
ever
movie.
Filmed.
I love that movie. It's that, to me, is up there with Sleepers in Seattle.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Oh, I just couldn't... Because that was... That's post High Fidelity for John Cusack.
Yeah, it's all... Yeah.
And he did Serendipity and Must Love Dogs, and in both of them... I think maybe by that stage, the rumors floating around about him being an asshole in real life had kind of started to emerge, and it really put me off.
He hadn't quite descended to the DTV realm that he had practically lingered in, like languished
still,
in for the rest of his career.
Still in today.
Yeah, but that was a slump because he'd been Hollywood's, you know, golden boy for a while. He was never quite a lead, but he was sort of, you know...
Well, he was always the thinking woman's lead.
Yeah, that's right. And Serendipity to me, and he always had like a long leather jacket in these movies.
Yeah,
and...
because that's why Gross Point Blank was such a revelation, because even though in real life he had been studying like martial arts his whole life and all that sort of stuff, but it was like no one ever thought that John Cusack would be in an action movie.
Yes. I had read somewhere in an interview said that of all the films he's done, there's only five that he thinks are good.
Yeah, right.
He only likes five of his own films. He's a career actor. He just, you know, works for the money, and as they should, you know.
Yeah.
But I think definitely High Fidelity, Gross Point Blank was another one. I honestly can't remember. I think maybe Better Off Dead was one of them.
Right. Men Out?
No.
Could have been in there, no.
But I think he contextualized Better Off Dead just for the era, you know, the type of movie it was.
Journey of Nettie Gann?
No, I don't think that was one. It might actually be like Map of the Human Heart. Which is the Vincent
Grifters?
Ward film.
I haven't seen that. Grifters?
Yeah. Surely see,
Grifters,
this is what I thought when he said it. I'm like, there's plenty of movies you've done that are good. But in his mind, I guess what he's proud of is only like a handful. So
yeah, right.
Interesting.
But then again, he's an asshole.
Yeah,
from
reports. Yeah, that's right. And these days, you'll notice a common thread in the movies he does. Not only are they direct to video, he's always wearing a black baseball cap.
Yeah.
It must be like...
Which is weird, considering he does not have any balding issues.
Well, he should be proud of bloody Love and Mercy. That's a great movie.
That's a great movie, yeah.
He doesn't look anything like fucking Wilson. Anyway, we'll ignore that fact. He made...
neither does Dano.
What was the one he made with Nicolas Cage that was amazing? The Frozen Ground, was it? The serial killer one? Played the Alaskan serial killer?
Oh, no, but I thought you were talking about Con Air, which is amazing.
No, he made another one with Vanessa Hudgens as well, and that's one of the great serial killer movies.
Oh, yeah, right, yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I think I remember that movie. I didn't know. I can't remember him being in it. But.
Yeah, yeah. He was and he looked a bit different because he had those like 1950s sort of glasses on, and he looked a bit nerdier than normal. And
what's the one with? Is it the Paperboy?
Paperboy.
Is it where he's with Nicole Kidman and stuff, and
that's
think
the one
Zac
Efron.
And he's the prisoner, and he jerks off.
That's a disturbing movie.
He's got his hands like tied behind his back, and she's just there, kind of making sexy faces at him, and he's able to like. You know, jerk himself off with no hands.
We start like sledging the guy, and now we're saying all these good things he's done.
Yeah, well, because
I like The Factory. That was a good thriller.
I think he's had a great career. I think he's those rumors have really kind of put a pallor onto them.
Totally.
But if you can separate that, then he like even like that one he did with Samuel L. Jackson where he's hiking with his kid.
Yes.
I actually really enjoy that film, whatever it's called.
What was that one?
You know, and I have met people who have worked with him, and they've said he's a total cunt. But do you remember in the real early days of the internet?
Yeah,
there was a forum or whatever it is, a website that was all no, it was Raid Cali. It was a website where people who worked in the service industry would tell stories about celebrities, you know, and they would basically, you know, true reels. And it was all John Cusack used to come into this cafe regularly, and he was a total prick.
Was it, do you reckon he always was from the get-go because he's a child actor from Hollywood, or do you think it's just jaded over the years? You know, he's been driven down to the DTV world, like he's at that point in his career,
he just no fucks
to give anymore.
You know, Bill Murray famously said that when you become famous, you've got 6 years to decide whether or not you're going to become an arsehole.
Yeah.
And from everything that you've heard about Bill Murray, he made the wrong choice. He chose arsehole.
I think he's making amends for that in his later years.
I think that's the...
The spin?
That's what he's trying to present.
Because
I don't know if that's.
I would love to. I'd love to go to his Caddyshack restaurant. Apparently, he's there a lot. And if you go to have dinner there, you're likely to see Bill Murray working the floor and serving you and stuff like that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, he owns it with his brothers, both of them.
Brian Doyle and isn't there? There's a there's
yeah,
four,
the other one
there?
From
there's...
that God Bless America movie. You know.
Yeah. That guy. But isn't there? Which is the one from
Caddyshack? The other Caddyshack, the one that wrote Caddyshack, which is
no. There's Brian Doyle. Yep. Yeah, but then there's another one. There's
like Ray Murray or something like that.
There's the one from what's the one? Groundhog Day. That's in the room next to him that he always meets on the stairs on the way out.
Yeah.
That's the other brother.
Is he the one in God Bless America?
No. Okay. No, because the one from God Bless America, I'm pretty sure, is the one from Moving Violations.
Yeah, I think so.
Who's like the kind of the younger, edgier brother. Well, but then there's the other, he's the fatter, nicer.
Well, I know
kind
this is
brother.
A whole like Wahlburgers thing. It's a deal where it's all the brothers have chipped in and they've opened, I think it's called Caddyshacks. And it's a golf, you know, movie
or
theme.
Cinderella, at least it's not Cinderella story. My life in golf.
Have we covered yours? Yes, we have.
Sure.
How about some boneheads then?
Yeah, let's do it.
Welcome to Bonehead Weekly Fun Size. We don't have a topic this week for those Australian folks. What would you like to talk about? Is there a movie you've seen lately that you like? I've got one.
I've got one too.
All right, I'll go first. I love The Black Phone. Now, I don't remember reading the actual short story that Joe Hill wrote to that's based on, but see Robert Cargill and Scott Derrickson do a fantastic job with the film. I did a review for Scarefest. The only complaint I can throw out of it at it is that if they cut about 5 or 8 minutes out of it, I think it would just be nonstop. And the big compliment I got to give it is that it has one of the best catharsis endings, you know, where you're like, ah, man, that's good. And not since probably Once Upon a Time in Hollywood that I was like, oh, this, everybody kind of gets their comeuppance. And it's just, I liked it a lot. I liked it a lot. And it had 2 or 3 good jump scares in it that got me. 2 of them got me.
So.
Chad?
Mine is not from this year. I just discovered this year it's from the 2020. It's a Dutch film. Yeah, it's from director Anders Thomas Jensen, who, by the way, is slowly becoming one of my favorite directors. If you haven't seen some of his films, I highly check them out. But Riders of Justice should be at the top of that list. It stars Mads Mikkelsen. I don't want to give too much away because there is so much insanity involved in this movie. But he plays a soldier who's off fighting in Iraq or somewhere over in the Middle East, and he gets a call that his wife has died tragically, and it's about him going home and joining forces with this weirdly weird group of computer people. Who are each very flawed in their own way, to find the real killer. And it's through a matter of throughout the movie, you find, and this Mads just slowly discovers that he's just as messed up as these 3 other individuals. It is a beautiful film, heart-wrenching, very funny. I highly recommend it, especially if you like Mads, because most of us in America know Mads, you know, as Hannibal, or from Casino Royale, just playing the really tough stone man who doesn't have really much range of emotion. And and a lot of his work with Anders Thomas Jensen proves that man is more talented than we give him credit for. So Riders of Justice.
All right. James.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to go with one that I've talked about before on Bonehead, but it literally is one of those movies that can pop in any time. It's very different than the ones you all have talked about with horror and your dramedies and whatnot. I'm going to mention it again just because I enjoy it. Brain Donors. It's called something else, Other Places, but Pat Proft basically rewriting the Marx Brothers. John Turturro, speaking of people playing against the type that they're usually associated with, most modern audiences in America might know John Turturro from Secret Window. You've stole my story. That George Clooney movie.
All the Transformers movies.
I don't remember him from the Transformer movies.
No,
I
refuse to acknowledge them too, you know.
But if you've never seen it, it is a straight up send up of the Marx Brothers. It's a night at the opera, except with a ballet company. And you got John Turturro basically playing a modern day Groucho Marx, who's a shifty attorney. And the three people and it's constant stupid lines and slapstick. My favorite one that I've actually quoted around colleagues is, that spells cash with a capital K. You need to go back to school. I hated teaching. It's just that type. If you like stupid wordplay, you'll enjoy it. I think that's why I like it. It's not a movie I watch when I want a serious movie, obviously. But when I just need something, it's something I can go back to and enjoy. So if you've never seen Brain Donors, it's gotten different titles other places. I don't know what it's called in Australia. But John Turturro, Brain Donors, written by Pat Proff, directed by Mr. Dennis Dugan.
All right. This has been Bonehead Weekly Fun Size.
I got it wrong. Joel Murray is the one from God Bless America, and he's in One Crazy Summer and Dumber and Greg and stuff like that. And John Murray, who becomes the fat one in Scrooge, seemingly, okay, is the one from Movie Violations. Gotcha.
So I guess you've been looking that up. So
and then there's Edward Murray. There's another one.
You probably haven't paid any attention to the Boneheads whilst you were looking that up, yeah? So whilst you were looking that up, did you know the Boneheads were talking?
Were they?
I just want to sort of address something that James said that I found most peculiar. He's talking about Brain Donors, and he's talking about John Turturro, and he says, like, people might know him from Secret Window. I'm like, I reckon that's the last place people would know John Turturro from.
Do you remember Jonathan Ross? Jonathan Ross, the British TV show host.
Yeah.
He used to host a TV show called The Incredibly Strange Film Show.
Yeah.
And he wrote a book called The Incredibly Strange Film Book.
Yeah.
One of the movies he talks about in that is one of the Edgar Allan Poe movies that Corman did, starring Jack Nicholson.
Yeah.
And in the review, he's like, I don't know what happened to this Jack Nicholson guy, but he's a fantastic actor, and he just seemed to disappear after this movie and was never in anything ever again. And it's like, it's because the interesting Jack Nicholson disappeared and he became movie star Jack Nicholson. But it's like, that's how
the
I feel like.
The eccentric Jack Nicholson, yeah.
I think that's how he's just like.
Okay. Because, I mean, it's not like he made Miller's Crossing or Do the Right Thing or The Big Lebowski or
Quiz Show
Mr. Deeds, even. Like, very sneaky.
I think you underestimate the stickiness.
But in all fairness, he did say most American audiences probably know him from. So maybe over there, the Secret Window's huge.
I love that he has a foot fetish in that film. But it's like, it's Adam Sandler's feet that he's obsessed with.
He just keeps sneaking up on them.
Let's watch that now. Let's just stop the show and watch Mr. Deeds.
You can't bring Mr. Deeds up without me quoting that one line every time it comes up is when he piggybacks that old bloke across the road and he goes, thanks for the lift, Deeds. That's a very good movie. I don't care what anybody says. But also, I just want to pick up on what James said about Brain Donors and that it was probably called something else elsewhere in the world, but it was called Brain Donors.
There's
here.
Brain Donors here,
yeah,
but
definitely.
Who knows what it was called in Turkey or Greece.
Japan?
Probably something in Turkish, I'm assuming.
Anyway, let's move on. By the way, go and visit the Bonehead Weekly podcast and check them out.
Check them out. They're a lot of fun.
If you've got the time, do the YouTube version because you get to watch them bounce off each other.
You get to watch them, yeah. I miss the hanging out in the couch days.
Yeah.
Of Boneheads.
I know, they just don't live in the same area anymore, but they did used to host the show from a basement on a couch a la Wayne's World style.
Yeah.
And it was a great dynamic. I would love to do that if I had the space, you know? I'd love our videos to morph beyond the desk, you know, and into something bigger,
yeah, yes, into a bigger space.
That's
well,
right.
Just a space with air conditioning that doesn't make any noise.
There's a trip behind the curtain right there. Yeah. It's hot in here.
Because it's a Nelly song.
That's
in here.
Right. Ben's taken off all of his clothes. Oh, shit.
Aren't you glad we don't film the show? Nobody needs to see that.
I do love that Chad took Riders of Justice. That was my number one film of 2012.
I remember talking about it on the show.
Totally, totally. Obviously, Chad doesn't listen to it.
No.
He does, though.
Well, I mean, he can still, no one needs to have a perfect memory. I can't remember the films I talked about 2 weeks ago, let alone a film that you talked about a year ago.
I like giving them shit because they've given us so much shit over the years.
Yeah.
It's just time for a little comeuppance.
Yeah, but usually I'm constantly surprised when one of their segments doesn't end with "fuck Ben."
I think Chad's very mindful of it now. I think his tone has changed a little bit, but Joe don't give a fuck.
No, he's just he just likes to stick the boot in whenever he sink the boot in whenever he gets a chance.
Right, yeah. Well, I kind of hijacked you at the last one of yours, so why don't you go ahead and do another one? By the way, have you seen?
You timed that very, very well. I'm going to talk about, like, I saw a film at MIFF, and it was a revelation to me. And the film, and I genuinely thought this was a great film. I'm shocked that he got the money to make it, and I was kind of shocked that he was going to have a career after this. I thought it was so good that he was just going to end up like a Phil Alden Robinson and just do TV pilots for the rest of his life.
Look that guy up.
The film is called The Myth of the American Sleepover. It did get a release locally through, I think, maybe Accent or Curious or one of those. It was one of those labels that Griffin released. It's directed by David Robert Mitchell, who would famously go on to direct It Follows, was his kind of big one, and then after that, Under the Silver Lake. And they share this kind of same timeless nostalgia quality, all of his films.
Yep. There's a John Hughes-ness to them, I reckon, if that's a term.
It just, all his movies feel like that, you know, that, and we didn't have it as much here, but in America they definitely did, like that start of school holidays where you've got like 3 months, it feels like 3 months off, and your time is your own, and
the equivalent of the American summer break.
Yeah. And that's what all his films kind of feel like. Like they're all set in that period, even when they're not.
The American summer break always cracks me up. It weirds me out because right now they've just come out of their summer break. So I'm getting on my Facebook all these photos of the kids are back at school, you know, first year, and they all take photos of that shit.
Yeah.
And I'm like, our kids are halfway through their year. Like, it's so weird.
I mean, look, I couldn't do it. Like, I love the idea of it, but then to go through the rest of the year with no holidays, give me 2 weeks twice and a longer holiday.
You
want to
go
times.
Through the whole year's calendar and reach the end with a reward.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, but you still, I mean, and that was the beauty of, you know, by the time you got up to year, like the best one is like year 10, year 11,
yeah,
where you don't have exams, you've just got a really long fucking holiday.
I'm loving this. I'm hijacking you again, man. This is like, this is like every other episode that's always done to me.
Yeah. But The Myth of the American Sleepover, funnily enough, this movie is actually set in that period of time.
Yeah, right. Okay.
It's all of these kids who have just, I think it's their last hurrah from high school.
Awesome.
And they're all about to go off to college or get jobs or whatever.
I love this stuff. Yep.
And there's different sleepovers, or, you know, different kids are having these different, or it's not the end of school. It's the last day of holidays before they all disappear.
I have to see it.
And it's the last kind of, you know, the last hurrah of their adolescence,
yep,
I guess you would say. And it just has this such an amazing feel to the film. It makes you nostalgic for a time that you never actually had.
Yeah, I love that.
And I was stunned by it. And I feel like his other films, like I said, have that same kind of vibe. Mm. I do find it very interesting that when I was researching this film after Under a Silver Lake came out, which I loved, and didn't seem to get any kind of real attention, I thought it was great. And and that's coming from someone who's always had, similar to my relationship with Burt Reynolds, has had a love-hate relationship with Andrew Garfield.
Yeah.
Though I really like Under a Silver Lake.
Yep.
But I remember seeing there's footage of him doing interviews about Myth of the American Sleepover and the start of It Follows. And he's like a kind of a regular looking, slightly nerdy kind of guy in a sweater, you know, like a Charlie Brown sweater and, you know, glasses and stuff. And then by the time, so It Follows has exploded and become huge.
Yeah.
He's made this big Hollywood movie with a decent budget under the Silver Lake. And he's at Cannes and people are asking him questions and stuff. And he's dressed in like a white cowboy kind of outfit with a cowboy hat, a white suit, and a fringe, and he's got hipster glasses on, and he's totally cocky and arrogant with the press,
right?
Like real, like a kind of really,
yeah,
you know,
John Cusack.
Yeah, butt you off, yeah.
Yeah.
And you're like, geez, he's really bought his own press.
Wow.
And then this movie's a flop. And you're like, well, I'm interested to see what happens next.
Suck that up, cockhead.
But, I mean, it is a shame because
good film,
pound for pound, I really, really, really enjoyed Under a Silver Lake. I thought it was a, it was released by Umbrella. I thought it was a crime that they only released it on DVD and they did nothing in terms of extras or...
It's a tricky movie.
But then they didn't get anything. That's the other problem too.
It didn't do much for me, I must admit. It suffered the same fate that Southland Tales did. Like, it was just a bit too weird and people didn't get it.
Yeah, I see. I mean, Southland Tales I thought was... Yeah.
But you know what I mean? They're saying like weird David Lynchy kind of stuff where, you know, a lot of interpretation required and, you know.
But it's just so, what I like about it is that the main character is so laid back.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that makes you like feel incredible. Like I really, really dug it.
I think I even in my review of that mentioned, I like so much about what I'm seeing, but I'm not making sense of it. And I think that was, you know, my issue with it. I just couldn't.
Well, there's definitely a not supernatural, but there definitely is a mystical
totally
twist.
But it's weird. I don't know what it is because at the same time, I can't make sense of Mulholland Drive, but I love that. Like, so go figure.
Yeah, Mulholland Drive is excellent.
Yeah.
But and I really liked Under a Silver Lake. It's actually, I'm due for a rewatch of it.
Cool. Well, this sleepover movie, like, how does it compared to, say, like, the Kings of Summer? Because I saw that at MIFF. I think it was a MIFF. And that's a summer movie.
I was going to say, for me, it's the 80s, 90s version of Dazed and Confused.
Awesome.
But it's just a lot more real.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Dazed and Confused is, as much as I love Dazed and Confused, it is a heightened reality.
Yeah.
Whereas this movie feels totally authentic, totally organic, and is just like it's almost like there's not even that much really kind of going on. It's like a slice of life.
You've sold me.
Kind of movie, and it just is so ridiculously watchable.
Yeah.
Like it is a great, like I was, like I saw this, I think I saw this the same year as I saw Linda, 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 maybe, I wonder if it's the same year I saw The Tower of Steve, which is a fantastic film with Donald Logue. No, I think that must have been earlier. But maybe Wonder Boys is that year. Mm. And it was just this spate of these films that were just like so relaxing to watch.
I love the sound of it. I'm definitely going to check it out. And like no other podcast in the world, I think, in the course of maybe 6 months have mentioned Linda, Linda, Linda twice.
As many times. Yeah. No one... It's me and Lucas Testro are the only people, and James Fergan, who I went to see the film with, are the only people who remember Linda, Linda, Linda and love it.
Good Movie Monday is made possible with the support of people like Viewlorium. Viewlorium is a streaming platform for rare and obscure movies, and it's absolutely free. They also have a catalogue full of kids' flicks, classic movies, foreign cinema, and more. Visit Viewlorium.com today to see what it's all about.
Here's a memory for you, Ben. Another one of my earliest memories of catching a bus with my mates without parental supervision to the cinemas to watch movies. And Ted was one of those.
Tickets were 60 cents.
Yeah, because I lived in sort of the north, sort of eastern suburbs, and we used to go to either Northland or we'd go to the Greensboro and... Just catching the bus when you're like not even teenage years yet, you know, it's exciting. And my parents didn't even know about it.
I remember my first trips going into the city by myself being like, am I allowed to do this? I'm not telling anyone that I'm doing this.
Guilty as shit. Yeah. I really did. Even just going to my local mall.
Like I remember catching, like at that point, I remember catching the train with a friend of mine, Alex, to come out to Ringwood to go to Oasis Comics and being like, I'm in Ringwood. I don't even really know where this is.
I remember that story. Yeah. So this movie, without parental supervision, it's not that spicy. It was Police Academy 6, City Under Siege. Now there's a franchise I adore.
What a great film.
Like we're talking a 7 installment franchise with 6 bangers. Like it is like from 1 to 6, I love them.
Yeah.
Absolutely love them.
Which is your favorite?
Well, that's interesting because for the longest time growing up, it was number 4. Because, you know, they had little David Spade in it.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
It had Sharon Stone in it, and it was Steve Guttenberg's final one, and I felt that that was...
And is what's her name in that one too?
Bobcat.
He's in it, but he's one of the recruits.
He's final one. No, he's now in number four. He's a bona fide cop.
Right.
In number one, he's the biker.
Yeah, he's the leader of the gang. Yeah. Okay, and then the next one, he's
Mickey! Mickey! That's number four.
Yeah.
That slow and motion run.
Who's the... Corinne Boora is his, like, girlfriend in that. And I always had a major crush on Corinne Boora.
She wound up in Veronica Mars.
She did. She's a drunk mum.
Yeah.
And but then she played... Do you remember that... what was that show with Cheryl and Fenn? Where she's, like, the recovering alcoholic.
Yeah.
And Corinne Boora is her, like, straight-laced sister-in-law. It really kind of, it was like, that's the wrong role for her.
To answer your question, so number four was my favorite, but as an adult looking back and having rewatched them many times, number three is the funniest by far as I'm concerned.
Right.
Problem with number three, it doesn't have Harris in it. Yeah. Has Proctor, but not Harris.
But it's got the other guy, Mauser.
Yeah, and
is it Mauser?
The one where they take his eyebrows off?
Yeah.
And that's funny in and of itself. Like, I think just the comedy smart.
Yeah, they give him the stuff. He's got no hair. They end up, like, the whatever they put the mace or whatever into the shower.
Oh, that's number four, I think, because that's Harris. Right?
Is that Harris?
Yeah. Because he walks out with his arms up.
And it's because it's not Lassard. It's Lassard's nephew or whatever it is. What's his name? Howard... The guy from WKPR in Cincinnati, Howard Hessman.
Yep.
And head of the class and all that sort of stuff. He's the kind of captain of the precinct they're all working. And so, it's Mauser and Proctor.
Number three feels like an odd... Actually, number two is the oddest one out because they kind of break away from the police academy in that one and they're on the streets, whereas number three, four and onwards brings it back.
Because Proctor doesn't actually turn up until two. Because he's not in the first one. He's got those two other idiot stooges.
But when he turned up, he was so instantly iconic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He's even in number seven.
And is four the one where Tackleberry meets his girlfriend?
Is it Colin Camp?
Colin Camp,
I mean, number four is a banger too, I must admit.
See, for me, it's always been... And it's not based on the comedy, really.
Citizens on Patrol.
No. Oh, that's the thing. No. For me, it's Mission. Not it's Mission. It's Miami Beach.
Oh God, that's a good one too. When they put Dork on his back with the sunscreen.
Yeah, Dork, and he farts in the lift, and he's being kidnapped by Rene Auberginois, and like they're okay with killing Harris, but they don't want to kill Lassard.
Yeah,
because he's just so awesome. But it's such a and Janet Jones kind of comes on, and that's the first non Mahoney.
Yeah, that's right. He got replaced by, is it Matthew Coy or...
Matt McCoy from Deep Star 6.
Yeah.
Replaces him. And
he's good.
He's great. Yeah. And Janet Jones, like, that began my absolute obsession to the point where she randomly did a workout video as part of the Firm series, her and Sandal Bergman. And I have tracked that down. And let me tell you, she does... They call the move the tuck center. And it's just her thrusting her hips in a white... leotard, and I've literally watched it on a loop for hours, mesmerized.
I used to always get so upset at the shit the Police Academy used to get. Like, people hate on it. It's like, but these people, you hate on it, but you've seen them all. Like,
I have a confession to make.
Yeah,
I have never seen Mission to Moscow.
Oh well, you don't need to.
I just feel like it's the massive gap in that.
Yeah, okay.
Like, there's no. I feel like it was a late.
It was. It came like 9 years after the previous one, something like that. Yeah,
and I just never saw it. Yeah.
And like, was it Matthew McCoy? Was that his name?
Matt McCoy.
He was out, and they brought Charlie Slatter in, like as sort of the Mahoney kind of character. They seem to keep getting younger.
Yeah.
I mean, you had a good chunk of the cast in it, but
well, it's always Callahan, and Bubba Smith is usually in it.
Yeah, he's in it. And Tackleberry, the petite
Hicks. Hicks. What's her name?
Yeah,
Huff. Is it Hicks? Huff?
I think it's Hicks. Yeah. And who else do you have? Yeah, Lassard.
Move, turkeys! Back,
dirtbag!
Dirtbag! Freeze, dirtbag!
Oh my God. What a series. But anyway, number six, it's the only one I ever got to see at the cinemas. Every other one of them I'd seen on video. And number six to me has a different feel to all the others. I think it's more theatrical than all the others. maybe since the first one. It's got a kind of sinister undertone to it, but at the same time, the slapstick is, I feel, on point with number six. Particularly, do you remember the klutzy guy? The
Hooks.
Do you remember the klutzy guy that would like walk around everywhere he'd go, he'd knock something over? And
Number six
has him walking through the office, kind of recreating the scene he did in an earlier film, like papers fly in the air.
Yeah.
Some guy in a wheel, like in a desk chair, goes, ah!
Was it Sweet Chuck?
Sweet Chuck.
Sweet Chuck?
Sweet
Chuck the fat guy?
Sweet Chuck and the fat guy. Sweet Chuck wasn't the actual klutzy one, but he was Bobcat Goldthwait's little sidekick.
Yeah.
Right? No, but there's another character that... remember his wife clung to the top of the car?
He doesn't want him to leave. Yeah.
That's number...
Fackler?
Fackler. Jeez.
Fackler?
Mate, we are due a marathon of Police Academy movies.
Yeah.
Oh, we should do it.
I always thought it was odd that you remember in the first one there's the Latino guy who's not really Latino.
They shave his head? Is that the guy?
No, he's the one that pretends to be a woman.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And then Callahan to sneak into the girl's thing. That's right. And then you find out he's faking the whole thing.
Yeah,
like he never made it back for another one?
No, I don't think he is in number two. But,
I liked his character.
Yeah, no. Number one is like, it could be a standalone movie because the sequels are cut from a different cloth, you know? They went from sort of a frat house movie. Like the first one, you could compare it to what? Porky's and Animal House. Moving on, they became a bit more family friendly.
Yeah.
Except for the Blue Oyster Bar. How good's the Blue Oyster Bar?
Blue Oyster Bar. It's such a good bit.
Yeah, I know.
Like, such a great bit.
It is, totally. And it's not even, like, depreciating. Like, it is, you know, it embraces
but
what
I love
it is.
I love that. I love the concept of, you know, gay toughs, street toughs. It's because they're into leather.
Yeah.
You know, oh, okay.
Arseless chaps.
Yeah.
Got the chains.
Like, the reality is, anywhere else outside of that bar, or they look ridiculous.
Yeah. Oh,
but
totally.
In that bar,
they look like Al Pacino from Cruising.
But you remember a while ago I talked about this movie called The Siege?
Yeah.
The gay bar that they razz in that is full of guys dressed like that.
Oh.
But much more realistic.
Do you remember those scenes in Cruising? They walk into that bar and there's just fisting galore. Some guy lubing up to go in.
I just love that the whole idea behind fisting is like
I can't believe we're talking about this.
Let's just see if we can. Like,
if we can.
Do you reckon it can?
Yeah.
Oh, maybe.
Turns out, yes.
Yeah. With enough lube.
I love that back in
I just would. But my big concern is like, what if it doesn't bounce back? What if you need to, have a drawstring?
We'll stretch the t-shirt that doesn't quite fit around the collar anymore.
Yeah.
I just love that back in the day when Chloe did a segment on the show, like, she wasn't sure what to watch one episode. I said, try Cruising. Like, give it a shot. And she was shocked.
She's like, oh, Al Pacino?
Yeah.
It's a mainstream film.
Yeah, after a serial killer.
Yeah. She never wore a handkerchief in her back pocket the same way again.
That's right. Ah, fuck. And you know what? Back to Police Academy real quick. I crack up at the fact that Steve Guttenberg is still banging on about, yep, we're doing another one. It's still coming. It's like they've practically all died.
My favorite thing about Steve Guttenberg is when he had his cameo appearance on Party Down, where he's playing himself and he's just banging.
Yep.
He's just super popular. Like, he's still famous enough.
Another Veronica Mars alumni.
Yeah, I just
adore.
But he plays a nerd in that.
He's the mayor.
He's the mayor. Yeah.
He's a bit sleazy. I love Steve Guttenberg in that era. Like, he to me, like, it was such an important part of the 80s. Like, when I think back to it, but I also love that we've talked about the entire Police Academy series from number one all the way to seven, and the only actor other than the Lassard, what's his name again?
George Gaines,
that lasted the whole distance was Michael Winslow.
Oh, no, Callahan.
Oh, did we talk about him?
Her.
No, oh, Callahan. Did we talk about Michael Winslow?
Oh, no, but we didn't talk about Michael Winslow. No.
Like, no, he was iconic.
He was.
And he's still doing that shit.
He's still, the same bit. He's in another movie that I really want to see. I heard them talk about on another podcast, and I've got the tape.
Yep.
Called Love Lines, where he's a, I don't know if he, how much of it, the star, like, I don't know, I think he's like third or fourth build, but it's like a kind of teen, like a, what was that show that you used to play here late at night? The Love Songs and Dedications. I think it's that kind of a show.
Yeah, right.
And he's the DJ on it, hooking up teens. Well, I think that's what
I mean.
It is.
If he rocks up to any kind of convention, he's only going to have two posters up. It's either Police Academy or Spaceballs.
I told you when a friend of mine, Larry, and I, when we went to Comic Con in 2005,
yeah.
And Cindy, what's her name? From Caddyshack.
Yeah.
Cindy, like Lacey, was it Lacey Underall? What's it? I can't remember what her real name is, but she was there. And Larry is a massive Caddyshack fan.
Yeah.
And he was standing in line, and when he got up to it, he had a little bit of a chat, and she's like, there's only two, people only come up and talk to me about two films.
Yeah.
And she goes, and I can always tell which film that person is into before they get to me. It's either Tron or Caddyshack. And Larry's like, oh, so which one am I? She's like, 100% Caddyshack. Like, yeah. He goes, yep.
And then got I rock up and she's like, but he's Caddyshack too.
Two, yeah. He's not lining up for me because I was not in Caddyshack too.
Ah, far out. Any more that you would like to talk about before we wrap this up?
I mean, I saw some great films. I'll just read some of
them. Do it.
So I saw Dead or Alive. There's a couple of Takeshi Miike movies. Audition. I saw Audition. There was a night where they played Ring 2 and then Audition.
Yep.
And Audition was the last film, and Audition was so good that I forgot what Ring and Ring 2 were about. Like afterwards I couldn't tell you. All I could tell was talking about was Audition. Yeah. I saw Brother, the other Takeshi Kitano movie with Omar Epps.
I love that movie. I love that movie.
It's got such an odd end. But
is that
the one where
you've got the shot of the, like, from the sink drain point of view, and like the gun is in the tap or in the sink and it shoots up? It's a weird ass.
I don't remember that. All I remember is that opening scene where I would think so. Maybe okay. You're not thinking of Ghost Dog.
No, but that's good too.
That whole scene where they go up to the top, they're both two fat Italian hitmen, and they get to the top of the building and they're just puffed out and can't do anything because they're exhausted.
Oh, I'd love that film. My copy of that's vanished. I had that on DVD and I don't know where it is.
Ghost Dog?
Yep.
Yeah, right. Well, it's on Blu-ray now.
Yeah, well, yeah. I have to upgrade it.
Suicide Club, the Sion Sono film. It was my first experience with a Sion Sono film.
Cool.
The movie starts with, like, I think 30 or 40 schoolgirls jumping in front of a train and killing themselves. Fantastic. Brotherhood of the Wolf.
Amazing. Christopher Gaines, I think his name is.
Christopher Gaines. And Seymour Cassell.
Yeah.
And what's his name?
Vincent Cassell.
Vincent Cassell, sorry, yep. Not Seymour Cassell. I wonder if they're related. No. Who's the Mark Dacascos?
Mark Dacascos, yeah.
Like, what a revelation in that film. Totally. You're like, I thought this guy was a B-grade martial arts guy, and then he's in this,
yep.
And he's fucking excellent. Virgin Suicides was one I saw there.
Very cool.
My Best Fiend for a Friend, the Werner Herzog doco about Klaus Kinski. this film is not yet classified. That great doco about the American censorship stuff.
Yeah, cool.
There was an LA Confidential doco that I saw that I can't remember what that was called, and it's got the great bit where I can't even remember the guy who wrote LA Confidential.
Oh, it's not Curtis Hanson was the director.
He directed it.
Yeah, I can't remember.
He wrote the Blue Dahlia and stuff like that. But there's a great bit in the doco where he's. LA Confidential had come out,
yep.
And he's doing a reading and a signing at a bookshop in his town, and he comes and does it, and when he leaves, these two old women come up to him, and they're like, oh, we loved LA Confidential, and he's like, thank you, that was great. And he goes, did you go on set? Yes, I went on set. Is Kim Basinger as beautiful in real life as she is in things? Yes, she's very beautiful. She's a great person. He goes, well, we love the movie. And he's like, well, great. Well, did your love of the movie inspire you to go out and buy the book? Oh no, then what the fuck good are you to me? And walks off. such a great story.
You've had yourself quite a journey over the years, certainly a bigger one than mine.
Well, this is pretty much just that 3-year period.
Yeah.
Before I decided not to put myself through like 5 movies a day. I just can't do it anymore.
Look, outside of Monster Fest, I don't enjoy festivals very much. Like, I don't know what it is. I don't like the patronage very much, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I don't like the conversations that go on, you know, because you know me, like, even at screenings we go to, I'm not a huge fan of discussing a film immediately, like walking out into the foyer and just having that discussion. Kind of like to stew on it for a while, but in those environments,
you often change your mind after a movie. We walk out of a movie and you're like, that was terrible. And then I get a message.
Yeah.
You know, I was thinking about it on the way home. I actually really liked it.
Well, that's it. It's the drive home that makes all the difference to me. And I don't want to come out of a cinema and like instantly have to have an opinion that everyone takes home with them. You know? Yeah. So anyway, that's just my little hang up. We should probably wrap it up. This Anything Goes episode has gone on. This is a long one. This is but Anything Goes, including the runtime.
The runtime. Well, we don't have a guest. We don't have a guest interview to to drag it out.
No, we didn't. We didn't need that this episode at all. Hey, thanks for listening, everybody. Don't forget to catch up with our team online. You got Jarrett, Guillermo, Joe, Chad, James, Chloe, Malzy, and Sam. You can find links to all of their platforms on our website, goodmoviemonday.com.
Is my platform on there?
Yeah.
Do I have a platform? What's my platform?
Yeah, I think it takes you to the MonsterFest page.
Oh, that sucks.
Oh, well, I can change that for you.
I don't have anything to do with that page. My whole life now is just Instagram stories.
Well, that's where we'll send people. Next week, we're going to be talking about boozy movies. And that's what us Aussies do best, isn't it? Drink.
Drink. Well, that's another story from Comic-Con. Larry and I met William Smith, the great William Smith, who admittedly, when we got up to his table, had fallen asleep. He was having a little nap. He was in his, by that time, he would have been in his 70s.
Yep.
But he woke up when we got there and got our DVD things or pictures signed. And the first he waked up and he goes, "Oh, you boys Australian?" And Larry and I, "Yeah." And he's like, "The only thing I know about Australians is I like to drink as much as they like to fight." And Larry and I looked at each other with two fat guys who'd never been in a fight in our lives. Like, yes. Totally intimidated.
Fucking oath. Yeah. Oh, shit. Anyway, that is us for another episode. Here's a song to send you on your way. Another movie I saw at the cinemas, Young Einstein. What a banger. Probably the best soundtrack ever in my eyes. It's just an absolute masterpiece of a soundtrack. So here is The Saints with Music Goes Around My Head. Have a good one, everyone. See you next week for a drink or two. All my life I've searched upon the reason for us being here, the universe and all that it contains. I try to find the secrets of the brain. 20 years I've labored trying